So thanks a lot, Giovanni, for your kind introduction. And let me start this presentation, which is about Pulp. So Pulp is an open source project started in 2013. And it's a collaboration mainly between University of Bologna and ETH Zurich, but then since that time many other groups in the world contributed to this project and contributed both to the research and to building this, let's say, infrastructure for embedded computing. So in this presentation, I will describe the main concepts behind the Pulp platform as a computing platform for extreme edge Internet of Things applications. So when we talk about computing and in particular edge computing, there are basically two different ways you can deal with it. The first way is to collect data at the edge or at the end nodes of the Internet of Things, transmit the data to the cloud, get it processed, and then get it back to the end node to perform some actions on the physical world. The other option is basically called edge computing, where you perform the computing at the edge, so in the end nodes of the Internet of Things, in order to get a more closed loop. So there are basically two main concerns. The first concern is about cloud computing, because basically the sensor connected in the Internet of Things might collect sensitive data, and the data might be sent to the cloud, and the people might doesn't want that this data is visible to others. On the other hand, this trend, which is going through, let's say, several vertical aspects in the industries, from logistics, smart cities and building, industrial automation and retail, is getting more and more, let's say, impact. So the second problem related on this side to edge computing is, on the other hand, related to the lifetime of the batteries. So basically, the amount of processing which is typically required to extract meaningful data from IoT sensors is getting bigger and bigger. And this amount of processing is suitable for cloud computers, but not yet suitable for very tiny embedded devices which are powered with batteries. So the question we want to answer in this talk and in this project is how to push very complex data analytics algorithms, also based on artificial intelligence paradigm, to systems that can consume only few milliwatts, okay? Let's say 100 milliwatt peak and 10 milliwatt in average. So AI is becoming one of the, let's say, prominent methodologies to extract information and classify the data, both in, let's say, high performance and deeply embedded applications. So if we take a look at the graph, we can see that there are fairly large model on the right part of the graph, where we have several tens of GOPS per second of workloads, and also quite large models composed of several hundred of megabyte of weights, which are obviously not suitable for embedding this model in very tiny devices with few megabyte, few memory. On the other hand, there is, let's say, a clear trend to shrink the models of neural network, both in terms of performance requirement, mega operation per second, and also in terms of memory. And this is, let's say, improving the suitability of MCUs, solar power microcontroller, to run this kind of models. On top of this, which is basically something that is getting down by the research communities, we can analyze a few features that make, let's say, AI models very suitable for hardware acceleration and embedding in tiny devices, which are listed on the right. So the high operation per bandwidth ratio, this means that every time you bring one data inside your chip, you can make a lot of processing on it. And this makes this algorithm very suitable for hardware acceleration. Massive parallelism, this is also a good feature for acceleration. Multiply and accumulate dominated. This means that with a few simple primitives, you can implement many of these models. And then other key feature we are exploiting in the PAL project is low precision and the model redundancy. So if we look at the landscape of microcontrollers, this is a plot from Jose Pineda from NXP, plus some updates. We can see that we have two kinds of, let's say, MCUs in the market. On the top right, we can see high-performance MCUs. Basically, high-performance MCUs can provide, let's say, performance in the range of hundreds of MOPS, or even more, but with very poor energy efficiency. On the other hand, we can see on this part of the graph, low-power MCUs that can deliver very high energy efficiency, but on the other hand, the performance provided by these architectures is not enough to run any of the models seen before. So what we want to do here is to create digital architectures that can sustain the computational capabilities and requirements of modern deep neural network with high energy efficiency. And how do we want to do this? So we started this project leveraging open source ISA, and in particular RISC-V ISA. So RISC-V ISA is an ISA basically standardized by Berkeley a few years ago. And the main difference between this ISA and other ISAs is that this ISA is designed to be extensible. So it was designed to be extended with the other part. So we started with the baseline ISA provided by Berkeley, which is not good for machine learning. And it is just not good for machine learning because it was not thinged for it at the beginning. So it was designed as a general purpose machine learning to be run on both edge and high performance processors, but with no, let's say, clear specialization towards an application. So we started improving the micro architecture and the instruction set architecture of our processor with a kind of lightweight extensions. So extensions that provide a lot of benefit in the specific domain, but without, let's say, jeopardizing the area efficiency and the energy efficiency and the performance in the general purpose domains. And we started developing, let's say, two different kind of extensions. The first kind of extensions, such as hardware loop, which are key in image processing, where you process the same operation over a big data window, post modified load and store operation, and the MAC operation. And all these kind of extensions can be used, let's say, with low effort by the programmer, meaning that these kind of extensions can be integrated in a very efficient way inside the primitives of the compiler. This means that a user of Pulp or of RISC-V, even without specific knowledge of the ISA, can exploit these extensions just writing C code. On the other hand, we developed a second set of extensions, let's say more specific to the domain, where we added some specific instructions, such as SIMD instructions. SIMD instructions, and in particular 8-bit SIMD instructions, are instructions that allows a user to execute four 8-bit operation in parallel on a 32-bit data path. So if you can exploit the reduced precision which is available in most of deep neural network, this basically means that you can speed up the execution of some key kernels by four times. And in the same line, we have added some extensions, such as dot product, which is one of the key components of neural network, and most, let's say, data computing algorithm, shuffling operation, bit manipulation, and operation for fixed points. And let's say all these extensions were added with the idea of keeping the data path of the processor as small as possible, because this processor, remember, is not meant to go on the cloud, but is meant to be used in very tiny processors with very small chips and small memories. So we tried to keep this processor as small as possible, in the order of 40 kilobytes. So remember, the area overhead we had in this processor is 1.66x with respect to the original one. So let's try to understand the benefit of these extensions on some real-life kernels used in machine learning. So let's say the king kernel of machine learning, as in, let's say, quite a lot of applications, is the 8-bit convolution, or more in particular, the inner loop of the convolution, which is basically a matrix multiplication. So what you need to do in a matrix multiplication? You need to bring in the data in the register file, you need to perform the multiplication, and then perform the accumulations. So if you use the baseline RISC-V ISA, what you need to do is, first of all, for each operation within your loop, you need to calculate all the indexes of the source operands in the array and of the destination operand. And this is done with the four add I you see at the beginning. Then you need to bring in the data inside the register file, perform the multiplication and the accumulation that can be performed basically within another tree. This is basically four multiplications and another tree. And then At the end of the loop, you need to perform the branch operation in order to go back to the for loop and execute this loop as many times as the application requires. So let's see how we can improve these exploiting hardware loops. So basically, hardware loops are finite state machines, which is added to the code unit, the code stage, not unit, of the processor, in order to automate the execution of loops. This basically means that you have an instruction at the beginning, you call LP setup, and you initialize the finite state machine at the beginning of your loop, and then you iterate automatically as many times as required by the application, without paying every time the overhead of the branch operation. Of course, the same, let's say, result can be achieved with loop unrolling, okay? Because if you increase the size of the inner loop of the matrix multiplication, the branching overhead decreases. But remember that we are working in a very tiny environment. So also the size of the instruction memory is one of the key elements. So it is much better to have a very small unit with very low overhead and keep the inner loop of the matrix multiplication small and reduce or eliminate the branching overhead. So the second operation that we show here is the load and store with the post increment. Here basically we say that we need to bring in the data of the current element of the vector and then increase the pointer to the next element. In the previous version of the code, we were doing this in an explicit manner by automatically increase the pointers, the addresses of the element, and then performing the load operation. Exploiting this kind of extension, which is the p.lw you see in blue on the right side of the slide, we can basically reduce this overhead from 8 instructions, more or less 8 cycles, to 4 cycles within the loop. This basically means that we can improve quite a lot the performance. So, finally, the last step towards a more, let's say, optimized execution of the matrix multiplication leads to the substitution of the explicit multiply and add operations, which are in this case 32-bit, with sum of dot product, which is one instruction which basically perform all of these operations in one cycle. And even more, instead of using 32-bit operation, when we can exploit quantization of algorithm, we can perform this using 8-bit instructions. And if we exploit the SIMD nature of these instructions, we basically mean that we can perform the same number of operations in 1/4 of the number of loop. So this basically means that we can reduce quite a lot the overhead. So overall, by exploiting these two kinds of extensions on this specific kernel, we can improve, let's say, the execution performance of the algorithm by 9 times with 1.6 time area overhead. And this basically means that we improved the energy efficiency and the area efficiency quite a lot. And please note that this is a general purpose processor, okay? So we are not only improving the execution of a single kernel, but we can improve the execution of other kernels required for artificial intelligence applications as well as other applications. So in this slide, basically, we see some example of applications. We have the matrix mool, 32-bit, 16-bit, 8-bit, convolutional layer, CNN layer, and other kind of kernels such as high dimensional computing, PCA, FFT, wavelet, FIR, and so on. And we can see that by, let's say, exploiting the first set of extensions, basically we can improve the performance by up to four times with respect to the baseline ISA. Of course, we can improve the performance much more where we can exploit the SIMD nature of applications. So if we can execute applications using 16-bit or 8-bit operations, we can improve the performance much more with respect to kernels where this is not possible, such as FIR or PCA in this case. But when we can, let's say, exploit all the SIMD nature of applications, we can see that we can improve the performance quite a lot. Okay. So this is good. We want to achieve performance. But what about energy efficiency? So one of the main bottlenecks for applications in low power devices is energy efficiency. So it's not much about the, let's say, pure performance of applications, but it's more about how many GOPS, okay, you can execute within 1 milliwatt. So what we can see from, let's say, existing commercial processors, such as Cortex, ARM Cortex M7, or ARM Cortex M4, is that, once again, there is, let's say, a clear trade-off between execution performance and energy efficiency, okay? And for example, we can see that Cortex M7 processor, which is, let's say, a more complex core with dual issue and advanced features, can perform with 5 core MART per megahertz, but with an energy efficiency of, a dynamic power density of 58 microwatt per megahertz. On the other hand, the Cortex M4, which is a much simpler processor with a single issue pipeline, similar to the processor I presented before, execute with 3.4 core MART per megahertz, but with a much, much smaller efficiency. So what we can exploit here in order to improve energy efficiency is using multiple simple processors rather than a few or a single very complex processor. So if we take a look at let's say the performance and the power of digital systems, not let's say from an architectural point of view, but from let's say a physical point of view, what we can see what we can see is that basically when we decrease the supply voltage of a circuit with respect to the nominal supply voltage, in this case we were assuming 1.2, is that as VDD decreases, basically we can see that the operating frequency of the system decreases more or less linearly, okay? And this is normal. So, on the other hand, what we can see is that energy efficiency is decreasing more than linearly. And this is caused by the quadratic dependency of dynamic power consumption with the supply voltage. Okay? So this basically means that we can exploit this feature of the silicon technologies in order to improve the let's say performance and energy efficiency of the system. Because we have seen that complex processors are inefficient, so we can put many simple processors operating in parallel. And we can reduce the supply voltage of our system in order to improve the energy efficiency of the system from a structural point of view. So, unfortunately, this, let's say, effect stops at a certain point because further reducing the supply voltage of the system below the threshold voltage of transistors basically makes the leakage power becoming dominant. So there is an optimum point which is called near threshold computing that can be exploited as optimal energy point to improve the energy efficiency of processors. So what we have seen is that machine learning algorithms and in particular artificial intelligence algorithms are very suitable for exploiting parallelism. So this basically means that exploiting parallelism in this kind of algorithm is very effective. So in order to create a pulp-based system, what we do is basically starting with putting multiple RISC-V processors in parallel. So we create clusters of processors of RISC-V cores, which typically goes from four processors up to 16 processors. And this is a limit which is given by the interconnect I will show later. So in order to exploit as much as possible the parallelism from these processors, we need to implement a way to let the processors sharing data in a very efficient way. So the memory architecture of pulp systems is composed of a multi-banked shared memory, where typically we have a banking factor of 2 OS4. What is the banking factor? The banking factor is the ratio between the number of memory banks and the number of processors. And a banking factor of 2 OS4 allows the processor to share data, minimizing the probability of bank conflicts. And one of the, let's say, key elements of pulp-based systems is an interconnect, which is placed between the processors and the memory banks, and allows to share the data in an efficient and transparent way with respect to the programming model. So let's see how this interconnect is done. So basically, we have a certain number of processors, which are shown on the top of this slide. And then we have a routing tree and an arbitration tree, which allows each core to access each memory bank in only one cycle. So this basically means that one of the key elements for implementing very high efficient communication between the processors is to let the processor to access the memory banks in only one cycle. Okay, the second element is which is implemented in the logarithmic interconnect is the word level bank interleaving. So this interleaving basically means that from the address map point of view, the first bank of the memory is mapped at address 0, the second bank at address 4, the third bank at address 8, and so on. And this basically allows the processors and the programmer to share the memory in a very transparent way. So this basically means that the programmer doesn't have to explicitly explicitly allocate data towards one bank, one specific bank, but that the data is evenly spread along on the bank. And yeah, the other feature is basically the low latency. We need only one cycle to communicate with the memory. So this interconnect is logarithmic, and this basically means that the interconnect, let's say, both the size and the delay of the interconnect scales in a logarithmic way with respect to the number of cores and memory banks. But still, all the paths you see here from the cores to the memory banks are on the critical path of the system for a typical system of 8 cores. So this is basically the reason why we cannot scale up the number of cores in a system like this to more than 16 cores. Okay, so another key element for improving efficiency of parallel programs is fast synchronization and atomics. So we have, let's say, improved our course with a dedicated units, which is described in this paper, which is a hardware synchronization mechanism which allows to implement key synchronization elements required in all parallel applications, for example, those programmed with the OpenMP programming model, in only one cycle or a few cycles. And the key elements or primitives accelerated by this unit are, for example, synchronization primitives or mutex primitives. And on the other hand, what we need here is an instruction cache, which allows its processor to execute in a MIMD mode. So we have designed optimized shared instruction cache in order to allow the core to fetch data in a very efficient way. Okay, one of the elements of a pulp system is the presence of a scratchpad memory. So the memory you see in blue called tightly coupled data memory is not a data cache. And the reason why we don't use data caches in our system is to improve, let's say, performance and energy efficiency, and reduce all the additional overheads which is required from caches. So in order to bring in and out the data from the L1 memory and the other levels of memory hierarchy of the system. We use a tightly coupled DMA here, and this DMA is used to transfer the data from the different levels of memory hierarchy. And finally, we have, let's say, at system level, a microcontroller, which is responsible to control all the I/O peripherals of the system, is responsible for accessing the external memory, which is typically not implemented like a full-blown DDR controller, because the power budget of this kind of DDR controllers is already above the power limit of Internet of Things devices, but typically it's implemented with Internet of Things memories such as Cypress Semiconductor's HyperRAM memory. Typically not, but this is the next step, I will show. Okay, so how do we program the transfers? So typically, during the execution of an application, what we want to do is to maximize the computation efficiency of the system. So what we try to do is to overlap as much as possible the data transfers and computation phases in order to hide the overhead of the access to the different levels of memory hierarchy. So typically in a pulp applications we have one RISC-V core which initializes the DMA. Then we have the event, then we bring the data from the L2 memory to the internal memory of the system. And once the data is copied inside the memory, the event unit automatically synchronizes all the processors. And at this point, the processors can start fetching the data from the memory and start processing it. So basically, in this step, they execute, let's say, the matrix multiplication we were showing before in parallel. When the processing is done, the processor program again the DMA in order to transfer the data to the external memory. So, during the normal operation of a pulp program, all these operations are implemented in parallel. Okay? So this basically means that, in principle, the programmer should take care of programming explicit DMA transfers, put all the computational kernels and manage all the synchronization of the primitives manually. So this is true for, let's say, many algorithms, but for deep neural network, what we have implemented is a tool or a set of tools which automatically take care of these optimizations. So basically, we have implemented a tool that starting from, let's say, deep neural networks framework models, take the models of the network and automatically map an optimized version of this model in a network. So, in order to, let's say, showcase this, we have, for example, implemented a mobile net network of this system, which is basically a network with 4 million of parameters. And hence, this network need to store weights in the off-chip memory. And let's say, if we take a look at the typical bandwidth and sizes of the different levels of memory hierarchy of the system, we can see that the L1 memory has a huge bandwidth. So the L1 memory is the TCDM memory we were seeing before. So it is composed of multiple banks that you can access in parallel. So it has a very huge bandwidth, but on the other end, it's a very small memory. And it is small because we want it to be very fast and to work basically at the same operating frequency at the processor. So the typical size for the L1 memory is in the order of 64 kilobyte to 128 kilobyte. Let's say 256 in a very scaled up configuration. Then we have the L2 memory. The L2 memory typically is in the order of 512 kilobyte to 1 or 2 megabyte. And then we have the bandwidth of this memory is 32 gigabit per second. So you can see already a decrease of one order of magnitude with respect to the L1 bandwidth. And when we go off chip, what we have are memories in the order of magnitude of 8 megabyte, even larger for the hyper-RAM we are using, but with a very, very small bandwidth, 1.6 gigabit per second at 250 megahertz. So what we need to do in order to let's say, process this data in a meaningful way, is to split large problems in smaller problems and take each portion of the, let's say, input tensor, bring the input tensor inside the small memory, process the tensor, and then copy the tensor out to the large tensor. And this process has to be done, let's say, not only from the L3 memory to the L2 memory, but also from the L2 memory and the L1 memory. And everything has to be performed in parallel and in parallel with the computation, okay? So here we are, let's say, tackling three different problems. The first problem is that off-chip memory are slow. The second problem is that on-chip memories are small. And the third problem we want to tackle is to overlap all the data transfers, both the ones from L3 memory to L2 memory, the ones from L2 memory to L1 memory and back, and the computing phase. And we want to do this in order to improve as much as possible the computational efficiency of the whole platform in an end-to-end application, in this case, a neural network. So let's see how this pipeline works. So what we need to do here, we are just showing the data tiling from L2 memory to L1 memory, but you should imagine another level of tiling in the upper memory. So what we do here, basically, we have in the first stage of the pipeline, we bring the data from the L2 memory to the L1 memory. On the first stage of the pipeline, sorry, on the second stage of the pipeline, T1, we perform the convolution kernel on the first tile, and at the same time, we can bring into the L1 memory a new data tile to be processed in the next cycle. In the third pipeline stage, we put the output copy back to L2 memory. We perform the convolutional kernel on the previous data, and we bring in a new data. And from the third stage of the pipeline to the end, what we can see is that we can parallelize completely the data transfers between the L2 memory and the L1 memory and back. So exploiting this, let's say, approach in, let's say, networks for mobile applications, such as MobileNet V1 or V2, what we've seen is that basically the L3 memory is never a bottleneck for these applications, except for the last layer, okay, because we have a lot of data transfers in the last layer, and the data tiling overhead in the end-to-end applications is around 5%. Okay, so we have seen, let's say, how to try to fit these models inside the clusters of processors using, let's say, more or less traditional techniques. But if we want to really fit these models inside Internet of these applications, we need to use, let's say, more radical approaches. So one potential approach is that of try to train the networks with exploiting, let's say, even more quantizations. So basically, nowadays, using 8-bit integer quantization is kind of a baseline. But if you want to fit these models inside Internet of Things applications, and here I'm talking both about memory footprint and performance, what we can do is exploit mixed precision quantization, where we have, let's say, some of the layers that can be quantized with less than 8-bit quantizations. So we have, let's say, demonstrated in the past that this is possible, and exploiting mixed precision quantization, we can, let's say, build networks with 8 times less memory footprint with respect to full precision, and 2 times with respect to int 8, with, let's say, a slight degradation of accuracy, which might be still good for some applications. So this was, let's say, a very initial work we have done a few years ago. Now we are, let's say, improving and extending the automated tools to try to make this heavily quantized network work. Let's say it's a hard job, but it seems that it's feasible. So the problem is that why this approach is good for memory footprint, it might not be good for execution on processors. Why? Because typically in processors, what we have seen is that we just have 8-bit units. So this basically means that if we go for 4 bits, 4x4, for example, multiplications, or 4x8 or 4x2, we don't have the hardware necessary to do that. So typically in a convolutional layer, in our library, PulpNN, we have three different parts. The first part is called IM to call, which is basically a part of the kernel which is responsible for reordering the input data in order to be suitable for its execution as a matrix multiplication. So by the way, this computational model is taken from the ARM CMC's NN library, which is an open source library as well. Then we have the matrix multiplication, where we have to decompress the compressed weight and perform the multiplication. And we accumulate the output of the multiplication on a 32-bit register. Then we have our 32-bit output data that has to be re-quantized and restored in the output buffer as a compressed output feature map. So this basically means that if we exploit 8-bit data, we have all the native hardware to execute the multiplications in our processor. If we don't do that, we need to pay some overhead. And in particular, what we can see in this graph is this overhead might also be quite huge. For example, here we have three different examples of kernels. The first kernel is an 8-bit convolution, the second kernel is a 4-bit convolution, and the third kernel is a 2-bit convolution. So we can see that the baseline matrix multiplication execution cost is the one in light pink. And we have already some overheads in the 4-bit and the 2-bit convolution to extract the compressed weight, which is the first part of the kernel. Then we have some overheads to perform the im-to-call function that we have also in the 8-bit convolution, but let's say this is a very small overhead. And on the other end, in the 4-bit and the 2-bit kernel is much larger because we need to extract also the compressed input feature map. So this means that from the 32-bit data, we need to take the different part, 4-bit or 2-bit, to implement the computations. And then we have another additional overhead for re-quantizing the output 32-bit data into 2-bit, 4-bit, or 8-bit data. And as you can see, this overhead is much larger for 4-bit or 2-bit convolutions, assuming that you don't have the hardware to do it within the processor. So the first set of extensions we designed in order to deal with this challenge is called XPulp NN, and it's an ISA extension for quantized neural network on pulp, so heavily quantized, down to 4-bit or 2-bit. So this, let's say, approach is quite straight forward. So basically, we extended the 8-bit CMD unit, which was capable of performing for some of dot product in parallel in order to deal with nibble seamed operands, so 4-bit element, or crumb seamed operands, 2-bit elements. So this basically means that this unit is now able to implement, to perform four parallel 8-bit operations in one cycle, or eight parallel 4-bit operations in one cycle, or 16 parallel 2-bit operations in one cycle. And then we have also implemented some extension to accelerate the process for the quantization. So from the, let's say, hardware point of view, the unit we designed looks like this. Okay, we have on the left the, let's say, traditional the traditional 8-bit units, which were available even before. And we added a multiplexer in order to multiplex the different units. So someone of you might argue, so why you did this? Because this, of course, replicates the hardware and increases the area. So actually, we tried also to explore other approaches where, let's say, you put try to merge together the 8-bit, 4-bit, and 2-bit units. But what we realized is that the additional multiplexers implemented inside the units were causing too big overhead and were having a huge impact on the operating frequency of the system. So we have chosen a different approach where we pay some overhead in area because we replicate the units. So we have one unit for 8-bit, one unit for 4-bit, and one unit for 2-bit. But on the other hand, we have a very small overhead on the critical path because the, let's say, only added logic on the critical path is the output result MUX you see in the bottom of the slide. So on the other hand, in order not to pay any overhead in terms of power, we added some slicers which basically perform operand isolation and clock gating. This basically means that if you perform an 8-bit SIMD operation, all the other units are clock gated, are not switching at all, so they are not consuming dynamic power at all, zero dynamic power. And this basically allowed to add these extensions to the processor without paying almost any power overhead, 2 or 3% at the core level, 0.5% at the system level, which is basically nothing. And on the other hand, we improved quite a lot the performance on the quantized instructions. So the second improvement we made to the ISA and to the micro architecture of the system is the MAC and load operation. So this goes in the direction, once again, to try to overlap as much as possible data transfers with computations. But instead of employing this approach at system level, this time we employ this approach at core level. So the rationale here is that load operation and MAC operation, or sum of dot product operation, perform different operations and use different part of the processor. So by slightly modifying the processor, it is possible to perform this operation in parallel. So this basically means that we can have we can add the dot product unit shown in the previous slide, the extended one, which was, by the way, already available in the X stage of the processor. And we added one bypass channel to the load store unit of the processor, which writes the data in a dedicated neural network register files where the input data is accumulated, and also to the traditional register file, which is used to support, let's say, the requirements of this operation. So let's try to dig in once again a little bit of assembly code. So we have on the left, basically, the full kernel of the matrix multiplication I shown before. So here we have on the top the initialization of the hardware loop. We have six load operation, the special load operation I have shown before with the automatic post increment. And in order to consume the wall data I loaded inside the register file, I need to perform 8 sum of dot product operations. Okay? So basically in the traditional kernel, I have, let's say, a density of sum of dot product operation, which is around 60%, okay? 55 to 60% of the time is on computation, the rest is on data transfer. So here already we can see that we are not parallelizing, we are not fully parallelizing, okay, data transfers with computation. Okay, if we take a look at the inner loop of the kernel with the mac and load, we can see that we have a few initialization operations. So we have some operations that we need to execute at the beginning of the kernel, but outside the inner loop. Okay, this is very important because we execute them once and then we stay inside the loop for thousands of cycles. And within the loop, we have the hardware loop initialization setup. We have just one operation where we are performing a load. This nnsot.p.h is just a load operation. And then we have 8 sum of dot product. So this basically means that when I'm inside the loop, we have 90% of density of arithmetic operation, which is much, much larger than before, okay? Okay, so just to try to understand the performance of this processor on here we are talking only about the kernels, so we are working on the.
Yeah. Okay, ask a question. So, can this optimization be, or is it supported at the compiler level? So you can just write C code and then this magic happens.
Of course, no. I mean, this is I mean only the V1. If you remember the first slide, the V1 hardware loops are supported by the compiler. Load and store with post increment are supported by the compiler. All the other stuff has to be added to the code as intrinsics. And our approach is actually slightly different. We provide to the user a library. We do to the user pulp and n. You have all the primitives, and using these primitives, which are written with intrinsics functions, you can use the functions. Otherwise, you can play and have fun as an expert user, advanced user, let's say. Okay, so just to give you an idea of the, let's say, the potential of these extensions. So here we are showing the energy efficiency. We compare it with STM32L4M4 processor and STM32H7 in terms of energy efficiency. The technology node is roughly the same for the S7, and it's a little bit newer with respect to the M4. But what we can see is that basically with respect to the original RISC-V core, we perform 1.6 better on the 8-bit convolution due to the MAC and load operation, 6 times better for the 4-bit, and 7.4 times better. Yes.
Are these measured results in silicon?
These specific, I think they are simulated, but they are simulated on a post layout database. So the power is basically 95% accurate.
And the STM?
Yes, is measured.
STM 7, are they measured?
Yes, measured.
They're measured.
Okay, yeah, and with respect to the ST processors, basically we can see, let's say, quite a lot of improvement, orders of magnitude. And the reasons for these improvements are basically due to the extensions which we added to the core. For example, ARM processors can perform only 16-bit SIMD operations. Okay? So this basically means that if you have 8-bit numbers or 4-bit numbers, you cannot take advantage of these extensions. Or ARM processors don't have load and store with post-increment, don't have hardware loop. Some, let's say, of these lacks of ARM processors have been fixed in the ARM Cortex-M55, okay, which is not yet available on a chip I can buy, as far as I know, at least. Okay, so we have seen that on symmetric kernels, 8x8, 4x4, 2x2, we can achieve quite good results. But what about asymmetric kernels? So basically, we still have quite a lot of overheads when dealing with asymmetric kernels due to the reasons we have seen before. So in order to deal with this lack, we started, we implemented a mixed precision processor, where not only the computing part is done in hardware, but also the pack and unpack part. And basically, this allows to maximize the SIMD performance, maximize register file use, data locality, because you don't have to store in the register file the large version of the data, and can support all the different kind of variants which are needed to perform the operation. So the problem now is how to encode all these instructions, okay? Because you have, let's say, quite a lot of variants for the sum of dot product, because you need one variant of the instruction for every kind of operation, 8x8, 8x2, 4x2, and so on. And then, if you want to have a complete ISA, you need to have these operations not only for the sum of dot product, but also for all the other instructions which are needed in processor. So we introduced the concept of virtual SIMD instructions, which is, by the way, an approach not completely new. It's an approach that it is used, for example, in vector processors, such as the ones used in high-performance computing. So the concept here is that the processor decodes a virtual instruction with no specific size for the two operands, okay? So basically, the processor decodes, for example, a sum of dot product, and then the user, through an explicit write operation on a CSR, on a dedicated register of the code, of the processor, encodes the kind of instruction. So encodes the size of the input operand A and the input operand B. So we can see here how this process is performed. So we have on the left the RISC-V assembly, where you need first to perform the load operation, then you need to use the bit manipulation extensions in order to extract 4 bit of the operand and extend it to 8 bit. You perform the sum of dot product and you pack it. So exploiting the ISA extension without a virtual SIMD extension, you load the operation, And then you perform the sum of dot product mix 8 by 4, for example. Okay? But as we have seen, here we have the problem of proliferation of instruction. So then, what you do with the dynamic bit scalable execution? We can perform the load operation, and then you perform the virtual sum of dot product instruction on the operation. Of course, what you need to do before executing the kernel is to set the CMD format. So typically, in a program implemented with this processor, you need to specify the CMD format of the operation, and then you perform the convolution. So fortunately, during the training process, usually you can train with a different precision layer by layer. So this basically means that typically this overhead for changing the format of the operations is very, very low, and you can change the format and then run the convolutional layer for say millions of cycles. Okay, so let's see a design example. So this is the Dustin SoC, which was presented last year at ASIRC. On the left, we have all the SoC infrastructure. So we have a RISC-V processor, L2 memory, the DMA for transferring the data towards the peripheral, FLL for generating the clock, and so on. And inside, we have basically the same RISC-V cluster shown before, more or less. And in this cluster, basically, we have the processors, the MPIC processors with the extensions. So if we take a look at the performance, so we can see that we have in red the Dustin core with the, let's say, mixed precision extensions, and in green the traditional RISC core. So as we can see, on 32-bit, 16-bit, and 8-bit symmetric operations, there is no difference, because the units used for this processor is just the same. When we go for mixed precision with 8 or 16 bits, we have improvement which goes between 1.9 and 2.8. And this improvement is due to the fact that you don't have to perform the compression and the compression in hardware, sorry, in software, but you can do this in hardware, as well as you can exploit CMD 4-bit and 2-bit operations. And of course, these benefits increases when you can exploit 4-bit or 2-bit CMD extensions, because you can parallelize your code even more, exploiting much more the extensions. But okay, the main point I wanted to make in this paper is not about the extensions, because the processor was already processed, but it is the amount of energy which goes into the memory and let's say into the instruction fetch flow. Okay, so all the overheads required by a processor to be general purpose. And here we made a power breakdown of the power, and what we can see here is that 20% of the power goes into instruction cache. So at the beginning of our project, this was more than 50%, so we worked a lot to reduce this, but this is not enough yet. So we have 10% on the instruction fetch of the core, 46% on the core's EDX stage, which is actually where I wanted to to spend my power, okay? Because this is basically register file and MAC unit. And ideally, in an accelerator, I would have all the power going inside this part of the graph. And then we have 24% inside the data memory. So what we can see here is that we have quite a lot of memory in the instruction cache and in the, quite a lot of power in the instruction cache and the core instruction FAT stage. So why we just don't use a single instruction multiple thread model like a GPU, okay? In a GPU, you have one instruction dispatcher, okay? The instructions are dispatched among several units. Of course, you can scale down a GPU to fit the power requirements of Internet of Things. So why this is not good? So there are several benefits of in using GPUs and related computational and programming models. So GPUs are very, let's say, easy to use. There are, let's say, computational models and programming models like CUDA, which are very well established, and they are, I think, accepted by the whole community. And yes, so here you have blocks of threads that are assigned to multiprocessor. And okay, the point I want to make here is that you have this unit here, which is called instruction unit, which basically is the, and this block scheduler, which is the only overhead for instruction dispatching for the functional units. So in this machine, let's say everything related to instructions is not so expensive. And basically, if you can parallelize the input workload, all the power goes into the functional unit. On the other hand, we have a point to clarify here. Warps execute in lockstep on the stream processors. So this basically means that the instruction unit, okay, has to keep synchronized all the instructions that are being executed by the processor. So this creates quite a lot of issues when you need to execute divergent threads. Okay, when you have an if, okay, inside your code, if else. So let's assume we have 8 threads going through the GPU, and you have 4 threads doing something, and other 4 threads doing something else. So this basically means that the instruction dispatcher needs to execute first the first four threads, and then the other 4 threads. So in other words, divergent threads execute sequentially. And while this might be acceptable in the high-performance domain where you have workloads which are huge and you never have divergent threads, this might not be acceptable in the IoT domain where I would say you always have applications with divergent threads. So what we developed in this context is a reconfigurable MIMD, multiple instruction, multiple data, VLAM, vector lockstep execution mode processor, where you have two different modes of operation. So in the first mode, each processor fetch the data from its own instruction cache. And this basically means that each processor can execute its own data. In the VLAM mode, basically the instruction fetch units and the private instruction cache of the slave processors are clock gated. This means that they don't consume any dynamic power, while the master processor, core 0, fetch the data from the memory and basically execute data like a GPU. Okay, so there are, let's say, some benefits related to this. The first benefit is that by reconfiguring the register where you set the MIMD dash VLAM mode, you can execute all of the threads in parallel, okay, when you are in VLAM mode, fully SIMD and fully lockstep. And then you can turn off the VLAM mode. And then if you have a branch, you can still execute your threads in parallel, okay? Because the processors are not forced to execute in lockstep, and the first four processor of the cluster execute some code, the other processor of the cluster execute the other code, of course, with the overhead of having the instruction fetch power. So there are, let's say, some issues related to this operation. So let's make an example of a matrix multiplication exploiting VLAM mode. So basically, here we have the diagram of a matrix multiplication, row by column, and we have on the x-axis the time with lockstep enabled. So we have that each core process one row of the A column, and all the cores basically process the other column. So this basically means that, first of all, we have all the processors in at the same time accessing the same data bank. So you remember the logarithmic interconnect of PULP? So basically, we have the word interleaving, and this basically means that if in a cycle zero, all the processor access the data which is placed on the same bank, all the other processor have to wait until the process is completed. And the same for the column of B matrix. So we have a lot of conflicts on the memory banks which sequentialized the access to the memory banks. So we need to find a solution for it. So there are, let's say, two different solutions. The first solution is hardware. So basically, what you can do is to put an offset in memory on during the allocation of the A matrix. In this way, the first element of the matrix of core 0 is at address 0. The first element processed by core 1 is in a different bank. And this basically allows to execute, to access all the data sequentially on the different banks and parallelize the access to the multi-banked memory. On the other hand, in order to solve the problem of the column of the B matrix, we need to implement hardware support for broadcast. So during the matrix multiplication, every core accessed the element zero of A matrix multiplied by the element zero of B matrix. We solved the problem of A matrix. In order to improve the access for the B matrix, we can add the broadcast. And this has, let's say, two benefits. The first benefit is related to the contention. You don't have any more contention. And the second benefit is that you can reduce the number of memory accesses for the B matrix by the number of processors, because with one memory access you can serve all the processors belonging to the cluster. Okay, Okay, this basically shows the same concept. Without VLAM, you have all the processors accessing the memory, and then in one cycle you serve processor 0, the following cycle you serve processor 2, third cycle you serve processor 3, and so on. And this basically is a sequential operation with increases quite a lot the execution time of the matrix multiplication. And this is not good neither for performance nor for energy efficiency, because you are using your hardware in, let's say, a non-optimal way. So by implementing this broadcast unit and, let's say, better organizing the data in memory, you can bring back this overhead to only 2%, okay? So you are still a little bit slower with respect to the original version, but only by 2%. So what is the advantage here, okay? So the advantage is related to the fact that in the MIMD mode, basically you have the power of core 0, which is this one. You have the power of the core 1 to 15 ID and X stage, which is this one. And then you have all the rest, which is overhead. This is the TCDM memory overhead, data memory, instruction cache overhead, and core and the instruction fat stage of cores of the slave cores. So what happens when we enable the VLAM mode? Basically, we pay a 2% of degradation of performance, but we reduce, we eliminate all this power, okay? And the part of the instruction cache power and the part of the TCDM power, because we exploit broadcast. And this basically means that most of the power of our cluster goes into the execution units, like in a dedicated accelerator or like in a GPU. Okay, this basically means that in terms of energy efficiency, exploiting this approach, we can save quite a lot of memory, and we can basically improve the energy efficiency by 1.5 times. Okay. Yeah, I prepared some other slides about hardware accelerators, but I think I'm too late.
It's really up to you, in a sense, if you want to cover
them. Okay, let's see, I will go fast through the hardware accelerator part. Okay, so the points I wanted to make here is that if you want to recover more efficiency, so we have seen the part about standard processors. We have seen ISA extensions. Of course, you have more room for improvement if you exploit hardware accelerators, where basically you create a dedicated data path to perform some dedicated task. On the other hand, what I've seen is that you always need flexibility, because in the Internet of Things there are many applications, and typically in a pipeline of an Internet of Things application, you don't have only deep neural networks, but you always have also traditional algorithms, so you need to be able to execute both. So the approach we use to integrate flexible accelerators inside our cluster is to use the same sharing mechanism for the memory. So this basically means that we use, from a programming model point of view, the processors just like processors. Sorry, the accelerators just like processors, accessing the memory in the same way, connected to the same interconnect. In this way, the main advantage is related to the fact that if you want to perform heterogeneous computing, real heterogeneous computing, where you have the processors executing some part of the task and the accelerator executing some other part of the task, basically you have all the data in the same memory and you don't have overhead for transferring the data from the private memory of the processors to the private memory of the accelerator. So from the computational model point of view, what you need to deal with is controlling the processors. So basically you need a way to write into the control register of the accelerator, and this is what here this control plane, and you have a data plane where you need to transform the streaming data semantic of the accelerator to the memory data semantic of the shared memory. So basically, when you want to access the shared memory, you need to explicitly specify the address of the memory you want to access. When you deal with an accelerator, you have a streaming semantic where all the data are transferred to the accelerator through basically in a streaming fashion. So here you have some address generation logic which is needed to some flexible hardware acceleration address generation logic which is needed to access the shared memory, and register file plus control logic which is needed to control the accelerator. Okay, this is just an example of toy accelerator, which is, by the way, available online, where you have some address generators which are connected to the TCDM memory. You have a simple, let's say, a multiply and accumulate unit which outputs the data to the output register. And in Pulp, let's say, we have a complete infrastructure, okay, to build these accelerators made of IPs that can be reused to deal with these off or other accelerators. Okay. So there are, let's say, some extreme approaches to deal with energy efficiency in embedded systems. One of these approaches is related to extreme quantization. So binarized neural networks, for example, are one of these approaches. So in binarized networks, basically you transform all the activation and the weights of a neural network into one bit. And let's say from a computational point of view, this basically means that every multiplication becomes a binary product and can be implemented with an XNOR. So this is an example of a chip we have done exploiting this accelerator. I'm not entering into the details of this chip. What I want to highlight is this. So basically, in this approach, okay, is an extreme approach because basically you use bits instead of bytes. Okay, there are all the problems related to training and accuracy. But the point I want to make is that if you optimize some part of your system, in this case the computational part, because basically you shrink a lot the part related to computation, you should always take care of the rest of the system. And This graph shows what happens when you execute a convolutional layer with binary networks. So if you execute it from SRAM, basically you have, poor energy efficiency, 115 femtojoule per operation, and you can do much better if you execute it from the SCM part. So SCM is a standard cell-based memory, and it is one of the approaches we adopted to improve, the energy efficiency of the system. So the problem we had, from the beginning of the PAL project is related to the power consumption and low voltage scalability of SRAMs, okay? So if you can do heterogeneous systems where you can implement part of the memory with SRAM and part of the memory with these latches, which are much larger in terms of area, but much more energy efficient, you can allocate some of the data in the L2 and some of the data in the SCM, and when you execute from SCM, you can be much more energy efficient. Okay, we have told about the problems of the training of binary neural networks. So the last accelerator I'm going to present is a much more flexible accelerator. And basically, the concept of this accelerator is you can implement binary-based quantization. And basically, you can transform a QNN layer with the two, operands of the layer, meaning activation and weights, implemented with two different data sizes. So the concept here is that you can implement binarized multiplications and then use scale factors in order power of two scaling factors in order to bring the data representation you employ for the network to the desired one. So in this way you can have quite a lot of flexibility, because you can implement any convolutional kernel with any kind of arbitrary data width for the activations and the weights. So this basically is exploit the same concept of the mixed precision processor, but targeting a dedicated data path. You can implement any kind of acceleration. Okay, I'm not entering the details of this accelerator. I just wanted to, recap the hardware acceleration approaches. So, all, this data is collected in 22 FDX technology. In a near threshold with high utilization assumption, so there is a minimal I/O overhead. So what we can achieve with energy efficient RISC-V core, so our baseline I presented at the beginning of the presentation, is around 20 picojoule per operation with 8-bit. What we can achieve with ISA-based extensions is an improvement of around one order of magnitude, still 8-bit. And if we go to a configurable data path, such as the accelerator I presented before, we can go to 50 to 100 femtojoule, 4-bit. And what we can achieve with a fully specialized data path and heavily quantized data with the 1-bit is another order of magnitude for binary or ternary neural networks. So the point here is that, in my opinion, if you want to be able, let's say, to deal with the challenges of Internet of Things applications and embedding this kind of algorithms in, let's say, devices with a lot of restrictions in terms of memory and power footprint, we need to use all of these approaches and, most important, implement ways that allows to hide and hide as much as possible all the different overheads you have in the system. So overheads related to the synchronization, overhead related to the memory transfers, overhead related to the configurations of dedicated accelerators. And let's say the only way to have the full control of this is to have the full control of this. And the way we are pursuing to do that is through open source hardware. And this is the reason why we built, let's say, this infrastructure we call PULP. And in this infrastructure, basically, we have all the hardware IPs I presented before, but also all the software IPs which are needed to program the platform, such as compilers, both GCC and LLVM, tools for mapping neural network on the systems, and programming models like OpenMP, in order to implement the non-DNN part of applications, which are still relevant in the system. And what I want to highlight here is that, in my view, only the full integration of all the layers from application to software programming model and silicon will allow, let's say, to deal with this challenge. Okay, let's say that all. Okay, this is one of the last chip we made. It is called DarkSide, and okay, I hope you enjoyed the presentation. Do you have any questions? The tool I presented briefly during the presentation, which is called Dory, it's a tool which it's called deployed oriented to memory, and it performs this kind of optimization. So depending of the shape of the layer, number of input features, number of output features, the weight, it let's say optimizes the tiling. Yes, let's say that this is something which is done, not by Dory, because we have a full stack of tools. It is done during the design of the network. So we have first a tool which quantizes and optimizes the network, merging layers where needed. And then we have a tool which is performing the deployment. Let's say no, but what we have seen, so no, actually yes. So the problem is, let's say, mainly related to the size of the instruction cache, not to the L2 itself, because let's say the L2, if you have 1 megabyte or 2 megabyte L2 memory, it's large enough to store off of the code. The problem we have seen is that there is actually, let's say, the instruction cache is the main problem we had during the whole PULP project. And the problem is the following. If you implement instruction cache with SRAM, you are going to burn 50% of the power there, and we don't want to burn 50% of the power there. Then we shifted to shared caches based on LETs. So if you use LETs, you basically consume 1/4 of the memory of the SRAM. The problem of LETs is that If you implement a memory with latches, it is much larger. So we implemented some sharing mechanism, exploiting the fact that in our computational model, typically all the processors execute the same instruction, even if not in lockstep. So we used this trade-off, replacing SRAMs with latches, and recovering the area overhead of latches by implementing a sharing mechanism.